Welcome to St. Martin the Fields, and welcome to the first of our 2020 autumn lectures. We're absolutely thrilled to see you all here. Trust and faith are really the same thing. Trust has come to be associated with something solid and abiding, while faith has come to mean something arbitrary and unsubstantiated. But at root, they're both about how what we can expect in present and future based on what we understand about the past, whether cosmically or relationally. Our autumn lectures for 2020 begin with the recognition that a series of events and culture changes have problematized the objects of our trust and our whole sense of living in a trustworthy society and universe. The format tonight is that our speaker will address us for around 45 to 50 minutes. He and I will then dialogue for 10 or 15 minutes, after which there'll be questions both online and here in person. There are microphones at either side, so if you've got a question, you don't need to put your hand up, you just walk to the microphone. Don't start speaking before I ask you. And also, but stay 2 meters away from the next person in line. And then also, there are two people who are kindly introducing questions that we get in the comments bar. So if you're online, and we're grateful to have you with us, then do send in the questions, and people here will read them out on your behalf. Not all of them, obviously. Tom Holland grew up loving dinosaurs and ancient civilizations. He became an outstanding writer of historical nonfiction and fiction. He's since become a TV broadcaster of great renown. If there were a chair in the public understanding of history, it would surely be his. In 2016, he wrote these intriguing words: "Familiarity with the biblical narrative of the crucifixion has dulled our sense of just how completely novel a deity Christ was. Most of us who live in post-Christian societies still take for granted that it is nobler to suffer than to inflict suffering. Christianity is why we generally assume that every human life is of equal value. In my morals and ethics, I've learned to accept that I am not Greek or Roman at all, but thoroughly and proudly Christian." About 10 years ago, a Jewish friend of mine said to me, if Christians knew the tradition in Judaism that they'd walked away from, if they truly knew what that tradition really was, they would kneel down and weep. I think the feeling you get on reading Dominion, Tom's recent prize-winning book, is, I wonder actually if it's written for me. I wonder if it's actually written for a contemporary secular humanist. It's kind of saying to a contemporary secular humanist, if you knew the depth of the Christian tradition and what you've walked away from and how deeply those values in our culture that you most cherish are rooted in that tradition, you would kneel down and weep. That's more or less, I would say, a summary of the argument of the book. It's a magnificent account of how much our present culture derives without realizing it from 2,000 years of Christianity. In launching our series, In What Do We Trust?, pondering how historically rooted and socially located is our sense of trust, Richard Carter and I could think of no better person to invite than Tom Holland. And Tom, we're absolutely delighted you're here. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that very generous introduction. Thank you very much for the invitation. And the incredible strangeness of the experience you've given me. This is the first time I've spoken to an audience not on Zoom since March. I'm sure for many of you as well, it must be the first time that you have come to a live event. So this is a very strange occasion in a very strange year. And in a sense, it provides the perfect context for trying to answer the question that you've given me. In what do we trust? What are the lessons from history when we try and answer that question? Because of course, it's a question that lessons from the present have sharpened to an incredible degree. Here we are. We are here, presumably because we trust that it is safe to be here. I am very aware that this is the first evening on which groups of more than six are not allowed to gather. And I'm no mathematician, but I think we have more than six here. But I'm trusting that that's safe and legal and okay. Equally, the fact that this is the first time that I have stood up and given a live talk for, 5 months now, again reflects the fact that all of us in Britain, across Europe, across much of the world, have trusted the experts when they tell us that this kind of distancing, of isolating, is the right thing to do. We have trusted that the government, that the health service, that the epidemiologists, that the entire structure of public health in this country, we have trusted that they know what they're doing and that they have the best interests of the whole of society at heart. Now, of course, that does not mean that our trust is total. I am sure there are some of us here whose trust in, say, the Prime Minister is not 100%. There will be some of us who trust the model set by, say, New Zealand. There will be others who trust the model set by Sweden. But all of us, I think, can have that bedrock of assurance that when we are told what to do, the people who are telling us what to do have our best interests at heart. And I think that sense of a kind of common assurance is evident perhaps even in the great wave of displays of public passion and anger that swept this city and many other cities, particularly in America, over the course of the summer. People marched through the streets of London in the conviction that Black Lives Matter. People assembled on the streets of London in the conviction that all lives matter. And there is a sense that, very evident on social media, in the media generally, in conversations across the country and across the world, that those two points of view, that Black Lives Matter and that all lives matter, are somehow contrary. But of course, in effect, they are not. They rest upon a common assumption, an assumption that human dignity, in the final reckoning, is not dependent on race or age or background, that all human beings are equal in their standing, equal in their status. And that if we emphasize particularly that Black lives matter, then that reflects a further assumption that I think most of us trust in, the assumption that those who perhaps suffer discrimination or poverty or disadvantage relative to others, that they perhaps have a special purchase on public sympathy, that if privilege by definition is privileged, then so also perhaps is there privilege in the very lack of privilege, the privilege to be heard, the privilege to serve as a reproach to those who are more assured in their rights, in their inheritance of privilege. So all of these ideas that might seem to have been generating tension, conflict, disagreement over the course of this unprecedented year, when you broaden the camera out, they actually turn out to rest on, as I say, a bedrock of principles and assumptions that actually most of us, whatever our political views, whatever our standpoint on the issues that surround how COVID should be treated or how Black Lives Matter should be regarded, that all of us ultimately can depend upon. The idea that all of us have an inherent dignity, the idea that those who are vulnerable have a special purchase on those who are in a position to offer them help. And so I think it is fair enough to ask, well, where do these assumptions come from? Are they an expression of human nature? Are they an expression of principles, of values, of ethics that are common to people across the globe, that have been common to cultures across the span of human history? And in attempting to answer those questions, I can't really think of a better venue than a church that is dedicated to St. Martin. This is a church that in many ways is the embodiment of the privilege that the Church of England in this country has enjoyed for centuries now. This is the church that has the royal family as its parishioners. This is the church that stands, you know, Charing Cross is the center point of London, one of the richest cities in Europe, and St. Martin's is the church closest to that point. And yet St. Martin in the Fields is famous as well as one of the great centers of charity and of charitable giving and of compassion in this city. I'm sad that the doors have been closed, because this famously is the church of the ever open door. This is the church that is open to everyone, to those who are hungry, those who are thirsty, and above all, those who are homeless. And the fact that a church so rich, historically rich, I'm sure it isn't any longer, but as was, a church that is at the heart of this wealthy, great city, is also a church that is so famously committed to helping the most disadvantaged in society, reflects the influence on history and on Christian culture, specifically of the saint after whom this church is named. Saint Martin, Saint Martin de Tours, as his name implies, was not an English saint. He grew up in Pannonia, what's now Hungary. He spent part of his life in Italy. He ended up as a soldier in what was then Gaul. He became, for long stretches of French history, the patron saint of France itself. And yet here he is also the patron saint of a London church. So he is, in every way, a saint for all seasons, a saint for all people. And yet St. Martin, Martinus, met in the course of his life a man who embodied a very different, a very alien tradition. Martin served as a soldier in 4th century Gaul, a time when the frontiers of the Roman Empire were coming under pressure from waves of people described by the Romans as barbarians. But the ultimate collapse of the empire, which would follow in the following century, was still a way off. The martial tradition of Rome remained strong, and the emperor under whom Martin is said to have served by his earliest biographer, whether he did or not is debated, but it certainly claimed very, very early on that he did. The emperor under whom Martin served was a proficient slayer of barbarians. The name of this emperor was Julian. And Julian was acclaimed Caesar partly because of his descent from a line of emperors, partly because he was recognized as a man of upstanding principle and quality, but above all because of his great military record. And Julian, in the best tradition of the Caesars, showed his gratitude to his victorious soldiers with displays of immense generosity. But it was this very displays of immense generosity that enabled Martin to stand up to him. It is said that after a particular victory, Julian handed out donatives to all his soldiers. But Martin, stepping forward, said that he would not accept them. Until now, he said to Julian, it is you I have served. From this moment on, I am a servant of Christ. Now, since Julian was, in the words of Christians, a pagan, someone who worshipped the traditional gods of the Mediterranean world, someone who was proud to define himself as a man who stood in the long line of philosophers, this was a brave thing to say. It is said that Martin was briefly threatened with death. He was spared, he was cashiered, he went on to leave the army to pursue a new life as a Christian leader and in due course a bishop. And so we have in this meeting between Martin, the soldier, Julian, the emperor, between the Christian and the pagan, the clash between two very different worlds, two very different ways of understanding humanity's purpose, the reason we are here on this world. Or was it? Julian was a pagan, but he was also a very complex man. Julian was a man whose hatred for Christianity, what he dismissed as the cult of the corpse of the Jew, was pretty much the animating principle that guided him in his career as an emperor. His devotion to the ancient gods was very ostentatious. He paraded it. And his particular patron was a goddess called Cybele, the mother goddess who sat enthroned on a mountain in Anatolia, what is now Turkey, and who in various incarnations had been worshipped for thousands and thousands of years. And it worried Julian at a time when people like Martin, soldiers, were turning to Christ, that the worship of Cybele seemed to be falling into disuse. Julian made a point when he was in Anatolia of going off the road up to the great shrine of Kybele and being devastated to find that it was essentially abandoned, that people were no longer going there. And Julian, in a manner that may not be entirely unfamiliar to the priests who are present here today, blamed it on the clergy. He said that the priests of Kybele were not doing their job. They were letting the side down. Specifically, Julian said, the priests of Kybele were not looking out for the poor. They were spending all their time in pubs. And so Julian made a point of granting the priests of Kybele a large amount of money to hand out to the poor, and thereby to encourage people who had abandoned the worship of Kybele to return to this ancestral worship. Teach them, Julian said to the priests of Kybele, teach them that doing good works was our practice of old. Now, Julian said this with a totally straight face. But the idea that the priests of Kybele, over the course of the centuries that had preceded Julian's life, had devoted themselves as acts of charity, was questionable. Essentially, what the priests of Kybele had enjoyed doing was dancing and cross-dressing. They certainly made offerings to the gods, and if you go to the now reopened British Museum, you will see what one scholar has described as a pair of nutcrackers, a pair of castration blades with which the priests of Kybele would essentially castrate themselves, offering their testicles as offerings to the gods. Charity did not fit into this. Nor was charity, the principle of charitable giving, as Julian understood it, the idea that the poor were there to be served by those who were great, those who had wealth, those who had power. Nor was it evident in the great epics to which Julian was devoted. In the Iliad, it's the strong, it's the beautiful, it's the powerful, it's the regal who are the favorites of the gods. The weak, the downtrodden are despised. Nor in the philosophers to whom Julian was devoted, there was no great tradition that emphasized the obligation of the rich and the wise to give to the poor in them either. The starving, most philosophers taught, deserved no sympathy. Beggars were best rounded up and deported. Pity risked undermining the self-control that a wise man should properly exercise. And yet Julian, devout pagan though he was, seems to have ignored all this. Julian genuinely seems to have convinced himself that the tradition of charitable giving was something that the pagan gods blessed and approved, and that this was something that the vast mass of pagan worshippers could place their trust in, the certitude that the gods cared for them, no matter how poor they were, no matter how weak, no matter how unfortunate. And so you have to ask yourself, how did Julian, a man so intelligent, so learned, how did he misunderstand the tradition that he held to so profoundly? And I think the answer is that Julian, as well as Martin, stands as evidence of how by the middle of the 4th century, just a few decades after the conversion of Constantine the Great to Christianity, just how totally Christian assumptions had come to saturate the mindset of elite Romans, of powerful Romans. even those who thought themselves opposed to Christianity. Julian was actually Constantine's nephew. He had been brought up a Christian as a child. And one of the reasons that he was so devoted to Kybele was that he believed that it was Kybele who had redeemed him from the darkness, as he saw it, of Christian faith, and brought him to the light of truth. But the paganism that Julian thought he had arrived at, the paganism that Julian thought Kybele had brought him to, was in fact far more Christian in many ways than the Christianity that was practiced by emperors who were overtly baptized. There is a quality to Julian's passion, his commitment, his certitude that that the poor can indeed trust in the beneficence of the gods, that they can indeed find that certitude in their compassion and their kindness, that in many ways is more deeply Christian than anything that was shown, say, by Constantine. And so the meeting between Julian and Martin is not quite what it seems. It's not actually a meeting of two different, completely contradictory points of view. In fact, it is a meeting that bears witness to the explosive growth of a radically new way of understanding the world. And one of the reasons why Julian's attempt to restore pagan worship, to resurrect the traditional habits of worship that had been practiced across the Mediterranean world, one of the reasons why this failed, why in the end the mass of people in the Roman Empire felt that they were no longer able to put their trust in the ancient gods, was that the argument that the divine cares for the weak and the poor was not rooted in the fabric of the myth and the philosophy that Julian held to. By contrast, the conviction of Martin that God cared for the weak was something that he could draw from the very wellsprings of his faith. And there is, of course, no story that better illustrates that than this one. And it's fantastic to be in a church where there is such a wonderful prop. The story is a famous one, but it always bears retelling. It dates to a time before Martin's confrontation with Julian and his dismissal from the army. He is a soldier. It's winter. He is wearing the heavy military cloak, the capella, that enables a soldier to keep warm in the winter of northern Gaul. And as he's riding out through the gate of Amiens, he sees there by the gateway, naked, half naked, shivering in the cold, a beggar. And so Martin takes his cloak, cuts it in two, gives it to the beggar. And then he rides on, thinks nothing more of it. But that night he has a dream. He dreams that Christ himself comes to him. And Christ says, "You gave me your cloak today." And Martin says, "When did I give you that? I didn't see you, O Lord." And the Lord said to him, as he had done on earth, "Whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers of mine, you did for me. Martin, this ex-soldier, this provincial, this man dismissed from the ranks, this nobody, would become one of the most famous men in the Roman world. And he became famous because of stories like the one that is shown here. Because he committed himself to the understanding that ultimately the poorest, the weakest, the most disadvantaged in society can place their trust in a God who, like them, has suffered, had been weak, had been poor, had been hungry, had been lacking a cloak. And the discovery of the rich and the wealthy and the powerful in Roman Gaul, that this could be a source of power, was incredibly destabilizing. Nothing like it had been experienced before. Martin had terrible clothes. He stank. His hair, we were told, was a disgrace. He was not a man who wanted power. When the people of Tours decided that Martin should become their third bishop, and a bishop by now in the Christianized empire was a figure of great power, of great authority, a man who exercised patronage. And patronage for the Romans was the ultimate index of power. So to become a bishop was to become a very, very great man indeed. But when people decided that they wanted Martin to be their bishop, Martin ran away. And we're told that he hid in a barn and only became a bishop because geese gave away his presents. And even when he became a bishop, he scorned the appurtenances of power. He refused to live in a palace. He refused to wear silken robes. He persisted in his awful haircut. And yet, the paradox, this served to his flock, to the vast mass of Christians for whom he cared, as a demonstration of the fact that he could be trusted. And so to that extent, to the silken aristocrats of Tours and of Gaul generally, this served to give them a sense that the world had been turned upside down. The traditional indices that signaled you could be trusted, education, wealth, breeding, had been turned on their heads. But a further paradox emerged over the course of the years that followed and the centuries that followed Martin's death. Because the trust that Martin's flock, the poor, the disadvantaged, the dispossessed, the trust that they had placed in Martin came to be shared by the powerful. To begin with, the aristocracy of Tours, after Martin's death, had just wanted to forget all about him. But Martin's tomb became a place of pilgrimage. It was said that great miracles were performed at his tomb. The power that he had exercised in life became a source of power in death. And that power, in turn, generated a sense, not just among pilgrims who wanted to be healed or comforted, that Martin was someone to trust in. It became something that the very powerful came to believe in as well. And in time, as the Roman Empire collapsed, trust in Martin came to replace trust in the structures of the crumbling empire. And when in due case the empire had fallen apart completely and the Franks had established a monarchy on the ruins of what had been the provinces of Gaul, the Frankish king himself adopted Martin as the great patron of his royal house. And the cloak that Martin had given to the beggar, the capella, became a totem of Frankish power. And special priests, capellani, chaplains, were appointed to attend it. And it was carried into war. And so the emblem of this man who had given away his military cloak to a beggar, who had resigned his role in the army and turned to the cause of peace, became an emblem of war. And over the course of the centuries that followed, Martin himself underwent a similar transfiguration. In the 12th century, in the great monastery that had grown up, in the field where Martin and his followers had camped out in caves and shacks, a great monastery had arisen in its place, a monk drew up a lineage in which he showed that Martin, this smelly bum, had in fact been of royal blood. And over the course of the centuries that followed, the cloak and Martin himself became emblems of royal power. Which is why in 1793, in the heyday of the French Revolution, revolutionaries turned up at Tours at the enormous complex of buildings, the great center of pilgrimage, so vast that it had come to be called Martinopolis. And they looked at Martin. You know, the Martinopolis was full of statues, of illustrations, of emblems like this. And they saw in it an emblem of everything that they were committed to overthrow. The power of the king had become fused with the power of the church, and both were seen by the people as enemies. They had ceased to be things that they could trust in. They had become the emblems of everything that had come to be mistrusted. And in the autumn of 1793, against the backdrop of a counter-revolution to the west of Tours, the great sanctuary, the great basilica of Saint Martin, was stripped bare. Statues were toppled. Fittings were taken away. Iron was melted down. A sanctuary can do without a grill, one of the revolutionaries declared, but the defense of the fatherland cannot do without pikes. 3 weeks after the process of despoliation had begun, everything had vanished, and the basilica itself was converted into a stable. And yet, by a paradox that seems to run throughout Christian history, it sometimes seems that almost every aspect of Christian history is an expression of paradox. The man that the revolutionaries were overthrowing was an expression of the values and the assumptions that had powered the overthrow of the monarchy and the assault on the Basilica of St. Martin itself. Martin, too, had been a destroyer of idols. He had been a scourge of privilege. He had been a scorner of the mighty. Martin, too, like the revolutionaries, had been a sans-culotte. There he is, giving away the clothing, the emblems of his status. And that in turn suggests a paradox that again, I think, has been fundamental to the revolution that Christianity represents. That if we're saying, what can we trust? The truth is that the values and the assumptions of Christianity that England, Britain, Europe have placed their trust in for so long are themselves and have been a source of immense instability. It's as though Christian civilization is like San Francisco, built on the San Andreas Fault. There may be decades, centuries where nothing much happens. Great buildings rise, great institutions spread, great wealth emerges, and then there is a great convulsion and a shaking and everything comes down. And the process of destruction, the process of instability, in itself, it's the source of that that we for centuries, millennia, have put our trust in, and which explains the paradox that destruction can be creative, and that often it is when a society seems most stable that it is most ready to go through one of its periodic convulsions. I think that the story of Saint Martin, this rebel who becomes an icon of power and of monarchy, and who gets toppled by people who are opposed to power and monarchy, and yet who himself is clearly part of the inheritance of assumptions and values that had inspired the overthrow of his shrine. I think that his story points to what it is within our society that we trust. Ultimately, we put our trust in assumptions that cannot help but perpetually challenge us, cannot but perpetually unsettle us. And if we want to know just how utterly saturated by those assumptions we are, we only need to look at the example of the one regime that has been constructed and raised in what was once Christendom since the time of Constantine that sought to overturn it. The French Revolution sought to overturn doctrinal Christianity, institutional Christianity, the Christianity of basilicas and relics. But it didn't seek to overturn the founding assumptions of Christianity, quite the contrary. It was powered by them. It would not have happened without them. But if we want the example of a regime that did turn its back not just on institutional Christianity, but the animating values and assumptions of Christianity, then we can look at the Nazis. The Nazis, of course, were opposed to the assumption that all human beings are created equal. They completely thought that the differences between black and white are fundamental. Paul's teaching that there is no Jew or Greek was anathema to them. They founded genocide on their rejection of that teaching. And likewise, the foundational message of Christianity, evident in the figure of Christ on the cross, the idea that the slave can conquer the master, that the tortured can overcome the torturer, that the weak can overcome the strong, that Martin himself demonstrated so potently when he took off the symbol of his military status and gave it to a beggar. That idea that the strong have a duty of care to the weak, and that the weak, by virtue of their weakness, may have a strength that is greater than that of the strong, that again was anathema to the Nazis. And the fact that within living memory, an attempt to repudiate those fundamental values that have structured Christian society and post-Christian society equally, the shock of that remains something so vivid that, in a sense, we no longer need overt Christian teaching. Because all we have to do, rather than ask what would Jesus do, is look at the Nazis and say, what would Hitler do? And then do the opposite. And that perhaps is why it can seem so hard for us in this strange year to find a sense of certainty, to a definite foundation, a definite mooring for values and assumptions that we feel deeply, but which nevertheless seem to be free-floating. They seem to be founded on an assumption that we should do the opposite of whatever Nazis would do. And they're founded on an assumption that values that previously, practices, ethics, values that previously had been taught by the church have now become so much a part of the welfare state, the hospitals, the schools that were organized by the church are now, we take them for granted, that we can all share in fundamentally Christian values and ethics and be complete atheists, complete humanists, regard Christian faith as nonsense, as superstition. And so I think what this strange, unsettling year has revealed is that although what we put our trust in as a society is in fact very culturally contingent, very much the consequence of specifically Christian history, Christian theology, Christian teachings, Christian scriptures, we no longer need Christianity if we are to trust in them. And whether that is a source of strength for our society or not is an open question. But it does much, I think, to explain the peculiar blend of the way in which we have simultaneously, all of us, taken so much for granted this year, and yet at the same time seemed unable to agree about anything. We have this vast inheritance in which we place our trust, and yet at the same time, so many of us have lost faith that the relationship between that trust and between faith, I think, is generating all kinds of fascinating tensions, the swirl of which are surrounding us, even as I stand here. Thanks very much.
Well, what a feast, and what a treat. I guess my job is to ask Tom to tell us about the 17 centuries that you missed out in that story, because it was an absorbing account. Obviously, for the Vicar of St. Martin in the Fields, it's rather gratifying to feel that the patron saint of one's church is possibly the most seminal figure, at least in the first millennium of Christian history, if not in the whole of Christian history. I take that as a rather gratifying contribution, so thanks for that very much. And then we skip straight to the Nazis. And I've never heard that description of the values of liberal democracy quite so acutely put, that we basically believe in doing the opposite of what Adolf Hitler would have done. I think that's a wonderfully succinct but apt summary of a kind of gut feeling, and it helps to explain why, for example, anti-Semitic attacks aren't just a deep problem for Jews, but send a shiver through the whole of society. And I think that's a really helpful little description of what the values of contemporary society are when placed on that visceral level. I guess my real job, Tom, is to push you a little bit more on, first of all, our contemporary situation. I won't use the U word, you used it once, that we all use about this year, of all the instances that we've never faced before. But to reflect on trust in this contemporary situation, but also, are there any parts, and you must have thought about this a great deal as you wrote Dominion, are there any jarring notes in that narrative? Are there any features that you see perhaps highlighted by the pandemic that don't accord with that harmonious heritage that you portrayed so lucidly for us tonight? Are there any things that it perhaps disturb you, or are there any things that are in our culture that are wonderful, good, and true, but aren't derived from that Christian heritage?
Well, I think that part of the problem with answering that question is that our assumptions about what are good and bad are themselves Christian. So I think that that to a degree, atheism and humanism within the West are kind of the logical endpoints of a tradition within Christianity, and perhaps specifically of Protestantism, that rejects superstition, banishes the sacred from the landscape, from the world around us, sends it up into the sky, and then ultimately it kind of dissolves completely. And it leaves, just as part of the narrative of Protestant propaganda is to cast the Catholic Church as a kind of repository of superstition and idolatry that has to be overturned. So Enlightenment thinkers, atheists, humanists now have turned those weapons against Christianity itself. And the arguments that are always brought up against Christianity, whether Christianity has been for good or evil, the Crusades, the Spanish Inquisition. Why do we condemn the Crusades? Because they inflict violence on the innocent. Why do we regard the infliction of violence as problematic? Because Christ said, put up your sword, because Martin walked out on the army. That tradition of Christian pacifism is one that people who would regard Christianity as inherently violent and militant have absorbed. And likewise, the Spanish Inquisition, what is it that is so shocking about the sentencing to death by a body of priests, of innocent people. What is it within Christian culture that might inspire a sense of horror and revulsion at that? Well, you know, you just have to look at the central image of Christianity, the image of a man nailed to a cross, to get your answer for that. So I think it's very, very, very difficult, as Nietzsche famously pointed out, for critics of Christianity to escape Christian assumptions. And the attempt to do that again, as the influence of Nietzsche on the Nazis demonstrates, can lead to some quite dark places. I do think that one of the things that that Nazism demonstrated, and you mentioned anti-Semitism, the consciousness among all those who would define themselves as Christian or as culturally Christian, that anti-Semitism has been the great blot on Christian history and the Christian record, I think is one that unsettles certain key Christian assumptions. And the reason for that, again, goes back to that famous statement by Paul, that in Christ there is no Jew or Greek. That principle that the Nazis rejected so violently, and which to an extent is kind of what underpins the assumptions of Western universalism. It underpins the assumptions of the multicultural society we have in Britain. The idea that all are essentially are one. Because, as Paul himself painfully discovered, there were plenty of Jews who actually did not want to have their distinctiveness dissolved into a kind of universalist mush as they saw it. And so the question of what Christians and the universalists who have followed in Christianity's wake do with people who reject their summons to enjoy a universal peace is, as it has always been, an incredibly live question. And I think that another reason for the decline of doctrinal Christianity in its Western heartlands has been precisely a sense of anxiety about the totalizing claims of Christianity, about the claims of Christianity to a universal status, because we've seen where that can lead. And so Christianity is rejected for the deeply Christian reason that it's become hegemonic, which is yet another of that snarl of paradoxes that seems to stalk every conversation of the role that Christianity has played through history.
So to take the logic of your argument further, and this will be my last question, then I'll start inviting ones from you guys. A strong Islam in this country is actually good for the renewal of Christianity, because it gets Christianity out of the mindset that it's simply the normal. And so in a sense, it provides an explanation why populists in places like Hungary, who present a kind of Christian normal as a reason for putting up barriers against Islam, whether it's Turkey joining the EU. Fancy someone wanting to join the EU, what a thought. Or whether it's refugees coming into the country, that actually the poverty of that argument would be offset by a true hospitality to Islam as, if you like, the principal alternative, although I guess maybe there are many overlaps, but there's the principal alternative worldview to Christianity globally.
Well, there are two I think, principal traditions that Christianity today is heir to in its attitudes to Islam and to other frameworks of belief that might be thought antithetical to Christianity. The first of these, of course, is absolutely embodied by Martin, caring for the beggar, and the model for that is self-evidently the parable of the Good Samaritan. And the point of the parable of the Good Samaritan isn't just that the Samaritan cares for the wayfarer who's fallen among thieves in his hour of need, but that the wayfarer is a Jew, and that relations between Samaritans and Jews are notoriously hostile. So the whole point of that is that the Christian message is not just for Christians, that the obligation Christ gives to care for the wretched and the oppressed is for everybody. And that was something that was understood right from the beginning, all the way through, you know, and indeed in the third century, a time of terrible pandemic, kind of blending the virulence of COVID with the revolting symptoms of Ebola, a plague that raged across the Roman Empire for almost 20 years. It was the willingness of Christians to care for not just other Christians, but those who were not Christians, that did a great deal to raise the profile of Christianity and to boost its prestige. So that's a very, very ancient, constant tradition. Against that, there is absolutely the sense that Christ said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life," and that there are enough instances in both the Old and the New Testament of people who refuse to accept the word of God and the martial response that this generates, to encourage people to feel that if people won't become Christian, then they should be forced to become Christian. And that also is absolutely part of the tradition that goes back a very, very long way. In the West, the tradition goes all the way back to Charlemagne, whose approach to the pagans in Saxony was, let's say it wasn't very ecumenical. It involved mass baptism and the slaughter of anyone who dared to repudiate it. So that also is part of the tradition. And so the articulation of Christian principle that both Angela Merkel, when she let a million refugees in, and Viktor Orban, where he put the barbed wire fences up and said that we're going to keep Hungary Christian, these are both part of the inheritance of Christianity. And Islam, of course, represents a peculiar challenge, as it always has done, again, right from the beginning, because Islam has inherited from Christianity the would-be universalism. Christ says to his disciples, "Go to the ends of the earth, preach the gospel." Muslims come to believe that Islam is the final revelation. It's the last chance that God is giving to humanity, and that unless the whole of humanity accepts it, then humanity is lost. And there is no way that both of those can be true. So there's a challenge. Mm-hmm. However, having said that, I think that Islam within Britain has been massively Christianized, massively Protestantized in particular, because what Islam, like every faith system that exists within Britain, has become, we say there is freedom of religion in Britain, and so there is. People are free to practice their beliefs as religions, but that is not how Jews and Muslims, say, traditionally had understood what they belonged to. Jews, up until the time of the French Revolution, thought of themselves as a people. They were the nation of Israel. And the condition of Jews becoming citizens, French citizens, they become French citizens, they're no longer allowed really to think of themselves as belonging to a nation called Israel. They can practice what Christians had been calling Judaism since the second century, but no Jew had ever done, is something that Jews have to start thinking that they belong to. They have to think that they belong to a religion called Judaism, which is something completely new for Jews. And again, when Muslims in the started coming to Europe in large numbers, they were told you can have freedom of religion. But again, most Muslims over the course of Muslim history had thought of themselves as an ummah, as a people. They did not think of themselves as belonging to something called religion that could be separated from something called the secular. But to have freedom of religion in a Western country obliges people from non-Christian traditions to accept that Christian concept of the secular and the concept of there being religions that exist kind of separately from the secular. And most Jews, most Muslims, indeed have accepted that. And so over the course of the decades, centuries in the case of Jews, there's been a weathering effect, and they have become, to that degree, more Christianized.
Thank you. Tremendous. Okay, this is it. I'm not seeing a long queue of people behind each microphone. So I don't know how we... Oh, look, just like that. Here they come. This is like being Billy Graham, isn't it? This is just some people just come forward. No, come as you are. There's literature at the front. There will be people to... Sorry, shouldn't do that. Go ahead. And I think Kath and Ben will emerge in similar fashion. Yeah, okay, go ahead.
Hi.
Do take your mask off to speak.
Okay. Hi. I was wondering if it could be argued that Christian ideology is not Christian ideology, but more human ideology. The idea of what is good and bad predates Christianity. So if we look at the myth of Baucis and Philemon, the idea of, I've forgotten the name of it, that you have to let a stranger into your house, the rules of hospitality. And in the myth, Baucis and Philemon, who are not very wealthy, let the Greek gods, not knowing that it's the Greek gods, into their home as beggars, and they still help out, and they are rewarded, which really reminds me of St. Mark's story. So could it be argued that these are not Christian values, but human values?
Thank you. I'll take Martin's as well. That's our tradition here. We tend to take more than one question at a time, partly to give the speaker a time to think about a response. Martin, you go ahead, and then, Martin, you go.
Okay, so maybe I'll approach it from the other way around. So rather than being universal values, I wonder, you spoke about how Christianity swept away a lot of the assumptions of the Roman Empire and the values on which it was founded. What I suspect is that a lot of secular humanists and atheists today believe that a lot of their values originate from the Enlightenment. And I wondered, and whereas you're pointing out how much of what we have today is actually Christian values and assumptions, and I just wondered, is there anything that the Christians superseded or swept away from the Romans, have the Enlightenment values actually, did they create anything new? Was there anything novel from them? And have those persisted, or at least at a minimum, really significantly changed what we would understand to be Christian values?
Okay, happy to take those two together, Tom.
Yeah, there were certainly traditions in antiquity that travelers, foreigners, guests from other countries should be afforded hospitality. And you, of course, counterpointing to the contempt for the poor that you get in the Iliad, in the Odyssey, you get when Odysseus appears to be a beggar, he gets welcomed by the swineherd. So definitely there are kind of traditions of hospitality that are part of the fabric of the classical world. But I think that what is radically different about the Christian perspective on this is that the beggars, the starving, the hungry have a moral value in and of themselves, and that ultimately, if you want to be close to Christ, then you have to care for those who are closest to Christ, who are the poor. And that is a radical subversion of the almost universal assumption in the classical world that moral value is to be equated with physical beauty, with breeding, with strength, with all the attributes of greatness. And the idea that someone is to be commemorated because of the concern he showed for a nameless beggar is something that is utterly shocking and subversive to an antiquity that essentially took for granted that beggars certainly were a nuisance and they should be, you know, scoured out of cities. There is, in the classical world, a sense of civic responsibility. The Roman Empire has provided doles to the people. There is a sense of commonality in classical cities among all its various citizens. But the essence of Christian teaching is that this should be universal. And it's that, I think, that underpins, by and large, the values that people in the West today kind of take for granted and assume are human nature, which brings us neatly onto the Enlightenment. I think that the whole mythology of the Enlightenment, the whole way it frames the world is inconceivable without the context that is provided by Christianity. And I think that is evident in the very word we use to describe it, Enlightenment, because it is drawing on traditions that are very, very manifest, particularly among radical Protestants in the Netherlands, in Britain, which provides the kind of smithy for the early Enlightenment, that Enlightenment is a coming of the spirit into the heart. That you are enlightened by the movement of the spirit that enables you to see what had not previously been visible. So the people who walked in darkness are brought into light. And that tradition, which blends with the idea that superstition is something to be overthrown, that idols are something to be toppled, again, is drawing very clearly, I think, on the inheritance of the Reformation, propaganda of the Reformation, which in turn, of course, even though the Reformation is setting the Roman Church as the great adversary, the early missionaries of the Roman Church had embodied as well. So Boniface going to the forest of Saxony decades before Charlemagne slaughters them all, he's chopping down the trees that are sacred to the gods of the Saxons. He's toppling their idols. He is bringing light into the darkness of those pagan woods as he sees it. And he's following the example of Martin, who did the same, who toppled idols and sought to banish superstition and to bring people into light. And ultimately, that in turn is drawing on the inheritance of Hebrew scriptures, the teaching of the Hebrew prophets that the idols of Egypt and Babylon are just stock and stone, and that the worship of these gods is superstition to be banished. So I think to that extent, the assumptions of the Enlightenment, precisely because they cast themselves as a repudiation of what had gone before, are in fact all the more a continuation of them. There is one aspect of Enlightenment thought, however, that I think does repudiate Christian teaching, and it's quite a topical one in light of the decision of the University of Edinburgh over the weekend to change the name of David Hume Tower on the basis that Hume regarded Africans as, by nature, inferior to Europeans, which was quite popular opinion among many Enlightenment thinkers, from Voltaire to Kant. And the reason that, for instance, Voltaire was able to think this was because Voltaire thought that humans had emerged in various different races. because he rejected the Genesis account of the creation of Adam and Eve and the teaching in Genesis, amplified by Paul, that all human beings are created in the image of God, and that therefore, ultimately, you know, as Paul says, there is no Jew or Greek. Voltaire didn't subscribe to that, and so he was able to believe that there are indeed different races, and that some of these races may be inferior to others. And so, really, it's the Enlightenment that gives birth to what, by the end of the 19th century, is becoming a doctrine of scientific racism. And I think the repudiation of that is witness to the failure of that dimension of Enlightenment thinking to overcome the much more deeply rooted Christian assumption that there is a fundamental shared dignity that all human beings have, no matter where they come from, no matter the color of their skin.
Thank you. Kath is here, and she's going to speak on behalf of the estimated 5 million people joining us online who are due a voice. Could you give us a couple of highlights from them, and then we'll see where we go with those, after which we'll go to Wendy.
I have a question here on behalf of Duncan McCall. For so much of its history, the Christian Church has backed the wrong horse. Supporting slavery for 17 centuries is but one example. Many others could be given, including the Church's treatment of women and gay people. How do examples of that sort fit with Tom's thesis that the assumption that all lives are equal is at the heart of Christian belief?
Can you give us another one?
I can give you one more, yeah. This is from Fiona McMillan. Is there not a fair difference between what's at the heart of Christian belief and actual Christian practice? So whilst the opposite of Hitler would be to practice radical acceptance of others, to practice radical acceptance of others, that's a long way from what's at the heart of UK society.
Okay, similar, couple of similar-ish questions. Yeah. So I'll take one more from over here, if I may.
I'd just like to take you back to the specific example of the difference between Angela Merkel and Viktor Orban's treatment of Syrian refugees, and ask you to explain again how both of those come from Christian assumptions. And if that's true, and they result in such different behaviours, should we be trusting in those assumptions?
Okay.
Yeah. Why has Christianity seemingly backed wrong horses like slavery, oppression of women, oppression of gay people? I think, first of all, we have to ask, why do we think that these are the wrong horses to have backed? Most people, for instance, for most of history, have assumed that slavery is entirely natural. Aristotle, widely held to be the greatest of ancient philosophers, the most influential, thought that slavery was entirely natural, that there were people who were natural slaves, there were people who were natural masters. Obviously, Aristotle, being a Greek, thought that the Greeks were the natural masters and that the barbarians were the natural slaves. But that is something that by and large, people for most of history have pretty much taken for granted. Christianity has always regarded slavery as an evil. But it didn't see itself as a campaign for social reform to begin with. It had its eyes fixed on heaven. And so slavery was seen as part of the common stock of ills that had followed the fall. Disease, hunger, inequality, suffering generally. That this was part of what fallen humanity was heir to. It took time for people to follow through the implications of the fact that Christ, by dying on the cross, had suffered the death that was distinctively applied to slaves. Crucifixion was the fate that was paradigmatically visited on slaves. And so as early as the 4th century, you have a bishop called Gregory of Nyssa pointing this out and saying that the whole institution of slavery, therefore, is something evil, should be abolished. It's not something that gets picked up because Gregory's own brother, Basil of Caesarea, famously humanitarian bishop, says, well, if we free the slaves, then who will look after them? So Basil kind of casts it as a form of very paternalistic welfare. But the sense that slavery is something problematic, evil, does kind of shadow Christian thinking, Christian practice, over the course of its evolution. And I think it's important to emphasize that what we call Christianity is a kind of matrix of paradox and change. It is not something that is stable. And you can see that, you know, in non-Christian terms as the working out of contradictions within the fabric of Christianity itself, within the ideology, the scriptural teaching, whatever. Or if you're a Christian, you can see it as the manifestation of the Spirit moving its way through the course of human history. And by the 17th century, that is something that becomes a very important perspective. The people who first begin to express in large numbers the opinion that slavery is a moral evil that has to not just be put up with, but has to be abolished, are Protestants with a very radical understanding of the Spirit. The idea that what is written in Scripture, for instance, it's not there on the page that matters, it's the interaction between the enlightened Christian, the Christian who has received grace, and what is said on the page. And it's that enables Christians over the course of the 17th and particularly the 18th century increasingly to argue that even though the Bible nowhere says that the institution of slavery is evil, nevertheless, that is what the Bible says. And I think that part of what leads the drive of abolitionism through the 18th century is that precisely that kind of radically Protestant understanding of where the Spirit can lead you. The other is the fact that with Anglo-American slavery, Atlantic slavery, it becomes racialized in a way that it hadn't been before. And that, again, imposes immense strains on Christian belief. It's okay for people like Voltaire, who thinks that different races were created at different times. It's not a problem. But for anyone who thinks that all human beings were created equally in the image of God and therefore have an inherent dignity, the fact that slaves in the plantations in the Caribbean and America are all African becomes a massive problem. And there are attempts to kind of justify this, saying, you know, that one of the sons of Noah was cursed and therefore it makes it fine. But nobody's really convinced by this. And essentially the strain of it is what precipitates this extraordinary kind of blaze of abolitionism that within the space of very few decades sweeps not just Britain, but the entire world. And we now are in the position where we look back and we cannot imagine that anyone ever thought that slavery was acceptable. Kind of expression of just how dramatically, I guess, if you want to see it this way, the Spirit has been able to change and transform and purge humanity. On the theme of women and gay rights, I think is complex, partly because the very idea of homosexuality again is a deeply Christian one. It's not a category that would have meant anything to, say, a Roman. That's not how people saw the world. The idea that the world can be divided into heterosexuals and homosexuals is one, again, it's a slow burn that only emerges after many, many kind of cycles of evolution over the course of human history. The words are only coined in the late 19th century. But the word homosexuality, when it does come to be coined, it's coined by a Catholic psychologist, who essentially combines the Christian sin of sodomy with the Christian virtue of marriage, and so that's why it's always been a problem for Christians to decide you know, are they against the sodomy aspect, or are they in favor of the marriage aspect? And certainly, I think that, of course, there are aspects of feminism and of gay rights that present huge problems for Christians, particularly if they are drawing on the Bible and on the inheritance of the great inheritance of Christian teaching. And I think that we can see where the gay rights movement, where feminism came from, certainly in the Anglo-American world, from the fact that they emerge in the 60s, and they emerge in the wake of the civil rights movement, which is a very overtly Christian movement. Martin Luther King, the Reverend Martin Luther King, is essentially summoning white Christians in America to recognize the dignity and equality of their black brothers and sisters. And the civil rights movement works because essentially enough white American Christians recognize the force of what they're saying. So the civil rights movement absolutely goes with the grain of mainstream Christian teaching. What happens in the 60s is that feminists and gay rights campaigners are influenced by the success of the civil rights movement and apply it to their own causes. So they are drawing on kind of Christian inheritance of campaigning, Christian assumptions about the right of the historically oppressed to receive justice. But because they are articulating assumptions that many mainstream Christians find offensive, the pedigree, the Christian pedigree of their beliefs comes to be obscured. And we arrive at the situation that we have now, particularly in America, where it seems that you have a block of Christians and a block of anti-Christians, a block of conservatives and a block of radicals. But the truth is that, again, this isn't a war of Christianity against anti-Christians. This is a civil war within Christianity. This is an argument about what aspect of the inheritance of Christianity you choose to emphasize. And that's the answer that I would give to you, is that Christianity is not a coherent body of logical formulations or laws that all knit together and make perfect sense. It's a vast complex of contradictory teachings that generates sparks that people historically have disagreed with. And the difference between Merkel and Orban, again, is one that, as I said, is one that runs throughout Christian history. Do you love your enemy, or do you convert him at the point of a sword?
I'm going to stop you there, Tom, because that, although I'd like to listen to you for the rest of the evening.
Sorry, I apologize, I'm going on.
I'm going to take, there's three people standing up. I want to honor the standers. We'll alternate, you first, and then from this side, and then the last person. One sentence each, I'm afraid. No long thesis now. We're into the last seconds, and then one sentence replies each, if that's all right.
I'll do my best.
It's like the end of any questions, yeah. You know, like that sort of...
kind of radio 20
seconds
panel
left.
Show.
Yeah, that kind of thing. Yeah. Okay, so off you go.
Following on from the Enlightenment, would you say that the Declaration of Human Rights following the French Revolution strengthened the concept of human rights or made it seem more like a construct that was quite wobbly at the time?
What a wonderful question. I think the
Doctrine of Human Rights derives from the 12th century theology. The genius of the West in its age of power has been to pretend that its culturally contingent values and beliefs are somehow universal. And the Declaration of Human Rights and the UN Charter are the kind of apogee of that. And part of why the West is finding the 21st century so dislocating is that as its economic and military power retreats, so its cultural and ideological power retreats as well. And values like human rights that people in the West, by virtue of their privileged status as members of the leading civilization in the world, had been able to assume were universal, we can no longer do that. We have to recognize that they come from a distinctive cultural soil.
It was a long sentence, but what a magnificent one. thank you. Your turn next.
Yeah, thank you so much for such a stimulating and enjoyable evening. I don't know if I can squeeze it into a sentence, but it was basically a question about the relationship between the Christian world and the ancient world as a historian of both. and how you understand not merely the contrast between them, but the generative qualities of that exchange?
I think that the relationship of Athens and Jerusalem is obviously, has been a cause of tension and debate, again, right from the beginning. I think that, of course, all kinds of dimensions of the classical world did pass into Christianity, and indeed you could argue that that Christianity, far from destroying the Roman heritage, as Gibbon argued, in fact was the prime agent in preserving it. But having said that, and I'm aware this is a very, very long sentence again, I think that what Christianity does is to transform our understanding of what the ancient world was so profoundly that it takes an enormous, enormous effort of will and awareness to see the world as the Greeks and the Romans saw it. We don't recognize the degree to which we've become Christian. It's kind of like we've breathed in the asbestos so much. You know, we can't rid ourselves of it. And one of the reasons why I wrote Dominion was precisely the realization that I was kind of struggling to articulate what it was that was distinctive and strange about the classical world, about Rome, about Greece, using English, because English is absolutely saturated in Christian assumptions. Every time you use a word like religion or secular or indeed homosexuality, you're engaging in anachronism because you're importing Christian categories and concepts that would have meant nothing to the pre-Christian world.
Thank you. And?
Thank you. You mentioned the Greco-Roman beliefs, one of which being that the beautiful or the strong are more virtuous, and you say that these have been superseded in a way by Christian beliefs, that this is not the case, that people are equal. I don't know if you've had anybody try to sell you something. They do not sell you new perfume by advertising it with a beggar. They sell you a beautiful woman, they sell you a strong man. I quite like living in a society which, at least on the surface, at least attempts to counter this by stating repeatedly that all human beings are equal in dignity and value. How do you do this without an established Christian church? How do you keep that going? How do I keep that going?
Thank you.
Bit of a miserable one to end on.
It's actually right at the heart of the evening. I think
it's a brilliant question, yeah. Because it highlights the strangeness, the weirdness of Christianity. The contrast between a statue of Apollo or Aphrodite and the high medieval representations of Christ, twisted and whip-flecked, nailed to a cross, are horrible. It seems obvious, it seems natural that we prefer the healthy and the strong and the beautiful. And so that just makes Christianity all the weirder that it triumphed so completely when it argued the opposite. Over the course of Christianity, so just like the Frankish monarchy enshrining as a totem of war the cloak of Martin and redrafting Martin as a kind of a figure of royal stature, so also are we always bound to praise the beautiful and admire the beautiful and be envious of the beautiful, because that's human nature. But it's kind of testimony to the enduring hold of Christian assumptions that we remain kind of slightly anxious about that, nervous about that.
Thank you. Thank you. Brings our evening almost to an end. I've got a few things to say to you before I let you go. First of all, that our next lecture is pre-recorded, Rowan Williams, 7 p.m., Monday, 5th of October, so there won't be a gathering here at St. Martin's for that one. But the two subsequent ones, the next live lecture is 7 p.m. Monday, the 12th of October, Neil McGregor, and then Paula Gooder, 7 p.m. here, again live Monday, 2nd of November. So don't miss any of those. Then to say that there is opportunity to give in the plate if you'd like to support this series and the rather perilous finances of St. Martin's at the moment. There's an opportunity to give in the plate if you're here in person. You can text capital letters LECTURE to 70085, LECTURE to 70085 to donate £5, or you can look online, if you're joining us online, on the Facebook live stream, or you can go home from here, pick up the repeat of the live stream, and then listen all the way till the end till I give you that text number again. That's another opportunity. Thanks for joining us tonight. Do buy this book here, Tom Holland Dominion, which covers some, but not all, of the ground that Tom covered tonight. I really do recommend it. It's an absolutely wonderful, wonderful read. And I want to finish, obviously, by thanking Tom. I think the two things I want to thank you for most of all, Tom, is that listening to you, like reading your books, fills you with a kind of puffed-up pride, fills me with a kind of puffed-up pride. I want to talk to a number of people in the next hour so I can pass off as mine all the extraordinary insights you've shared with us tonight. And I can say, oh, no, I've done the research. I can be sure of that. And the connections that you've made, particularly, if I may say so, in these last few questions, both the ability to, you know, insert so many semicolons in a single sentence, and also, but to get to the heart of the issues of our society in a way that I think most of us tonight just haven't really seriously thought about before, and yet has been staring us in our face all our lives. So thank you for that, but also thank you in a place that, you know, was built by a king, and as you pointed out, is, you know, has Buckingham Palace and its parish and so on, and in so ways is so much part of the establishment as St. Martin the Fields, for reminding us tonight of the strangeness of Christianity and the way it cuts against so many of our instincts and takes us to a dangerous and yet wonderful place. Thanks for the reminder of that, which I think we all need. We're so grateful to you. It's just been a fabulous evening, wonderful dialogue, fascinating presentation. Thank you so much for joining us. Thank you.